That it was the Arab intellectuals who made a major contribution to the ideological, creative, artistic, what do you call, things that were happening during the Renaissance period, movements, really speaking, or new thoughts coming in. All these things were not happening in isolation, but it was thanks to the catalyst kind of medium provided by the Arab thinkers that the Renaissance processes could come about. They could happen. As an example, we discussed Avicenna yesterday, or Ibn Sina, who's a premier Arab intellectual who was a man of many hats, really speaking. He is also a physician, he is also a geologist, he is also a philosopher, mathematician. Here we took the example of Avicenna's book, which is called as Canon of Medicine. Avicenna was belonging to the what century? He belonged to which century? Do you remember from yesterday?
Fifteenth and sixteenth.
No, ma'am.
Which? Avicenna. Here, see, 980 till 1037. So he lived in the 10th and the 11th century. 10th and the 11th century. He had some kind of a connection because of the, Byzantium being the capital city of the Eastern Roman Empire. He had access to an interest in what Aristotle, Plato, Socrates, all these philosophers and mathematicians, all those people had done during the Greco-Roman period. So he studied the text, offered their translations in the Arabic language, which were very, very useful for people like Albertus Magnus or Albertus Magnus, who were writing during the 13th century and even later on during the 14th, 15th, during the Renaissance period. So it's a kind of a convoluted journey of something happening in the Western Roman Empire, the Greco-Roman thinking, philosophy, all these processes happening. Then these getting transferred, translated, thanks to the Arab thinkers in Byzantium, which is Constantinople, Turkey today. And this again gets retranslated, reinterpreted, reimagined, rejuvenated during the Renaissance period. So one can see these three different points, really speaking. First is the Greco-Roman Empire, then comes Byzantium, where there's a lot of learning happening about European, Greco-Roman classical thoughts, and then this getting reinterpreted during the Renaissance period. So we cannot really bypass the contribution of Arab Avicenna. That is the point that we made yesterday. These are some of the pictures from a manuscript that he had written. Pictures are drawn by Avicenna. Pictures are by illustrators who were copying the text of Avicenna. But for us, it's important to know that Avicenna is somebody who's writing in the 10th and the 11th centuries, and he still knows that there are different systems within the body. So the knowledge of anatomy that he has is important, and this, of course, has connections with the Greco-Roman learning. Okay, we also saw that Avicenna is not the only person to offer his services, not services, offer his contribution to this process of contributing to knowledge. There are many others, and the names are here in the slide. So basically, Encyclopedia Britannica also recognizes that it is first through Sicily and Spain, and then via the Crusades, the rich cultural enlightenment of the Islamic world awakened a benighted Europe. Benighted it as if it was sleeping. And Avicenna, perhaps being the greatest ambassador of this culture, cultural transition of Arab thinkers was a point where we stopped yesterday. Today we'll move on to that point being, of course, one of the characteristic features of the process called as the European Renaissance. We are looking at the nature and various processes involved the European Renaissance. Today we'll be moving ahead, and here the next point is what were the factors that brought about these various interactions, these various ways of reinterpreting the classical Greco-Roman tradition. And a major factor is the Crusades. Crusades are nothing but the religious wars, or wars based on the beliefs that people had, and primarily being fought between the Christians and the Muslims over the Christian access to the holy places in Jerusalem. Jerusalem being a contested territory. We also saw one of the earlier lectures that this is a place which is holy for three religions at least, Judaism, Christianity and Islam. So a lot of fighting happening. For us, it's not important to understand who fought whom and who won what in which year. It's important for us to know that Crusades offered an opportunity, they offered an avenue for people to move out of their confinement, of their existence as slaves or existence as serfs, S-E-R-F-S. Serfs were the people who worked on the feudal lord's land. So these people who were having an existence which is kind of isolated in their own villages, they had the opportunity to get out of their villages and have a look at what is happening in and around Europe, and also fight for religious glory. So Crusades are an important medium for people to widen the horizons of their intellect, of their thinking. Here one can see a picture which is also a major indication of how it is the winners who write history. One can see that Philip and Richard take the keys of the acre. Acre is nothing but an area in Jerusalem which is very, very very, very important, considered as holy. And this place kept on exchanging, the control of this place kept moving back and forth between the Muslims and the Christians. So here is one of the battles that happened in 1192, where it is who's the victor and who's the vanquished. Can you tell me? Who lost this? Don't want to think.
Crusades won, no, ma'am?
Yeah, pardon me?
Crusades won?
Yeah, Crusades 1192. This specific crusade. Who seems to have won this specific crusade?
Philip and Richard.
Why?
It depicts in the picture itself. They're taking the keys from. Who are they?
Yes, who are they? That is the question. They are not even named. We don't. I mean, there's no distinguishing feature whatsoever, as if these are, some soldiers who have been defeated, that's all, right?
Yeah.
So Philip and Richard, they seem to be some important people, obviously. They won this specific battle, specific crusade, and it is these defeated people who are shown in very clear terms as defeated people. These people are offering the key to that, the acre, that is that specific area which is considered as very holy. Point that I am trying to drive is that pictures tell a lot about who seems to have been in political control of the situation. Agreed?
Yes, ma'am, of course.
Okay. Right. So there were many such crusades that happened. This particular crusade was won by the obviously the Christians. There were others which were won by the Muslims, and they went on happening. The seventh one being quite important. That's why the picture here. But they did not stop at 1192. Battles went on and on and on. And the next picture will speak about how this had become a kind of a lifestyle for people. So it, the whole SOP was ready for people. When a crusade was called for, people would get ready, you know, with horses and with boat sailing, and people having proper packages in the boats. Huh? So the whole SOP, standard operating procedure, was really in place. They were crusades had become a part of the political religious life of Europe in this century. This one is one of the last ones. Battle of Nicopolis happened in the towards the end of the 14th century. Battle of Nicopolis. What do you see here? What seems to have happened?
Ma'am, I have a different interpretation of this image, ma'am. Ma'am, I see the men are not Arabs or Caucasians, but Mongoloid.
Yes.
Either they seem to be men of Hani who have overrun Arabs. Maybe, I'm not sure.
Or at least the painter imagined them to be looking like that, because the painter obviously was not a part of the battle. Yeah, what else? Do you see some kind of a contrast between the Vedic Christian? You want to say something?
Nay, ma'am. I'm trying to understand. I understand very little about art.
Okay. I heard something from your mic, so I asked you. Okay. Yeah. See here. These people obviously seem to be tech savvy with their cannons, little ones, but still cannons all the same. And these guys, rich and opulent, but obviously not very resourceful when it comes to technology. Would you say that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Even in here on the right side, this picture, one can see. What do you see here? Some people are obviously
butchered.
They are prisoners of and here disembodied, dead, naked, defeated.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Also, one is also another picture of the Battle of Nicopolis, crusade happening here. So here also you can see men or perhaps women also, quite possibly, being taken as prisoners of war. So this whole, these two, three pictures are given so as to help us understand that crusades had become a large-scale enterprise, as it were, during the 11th, 12th, 13th, even the 14th century. People find the time and the paint them all.
Ma'am, can I ask something? Is it true that the, this is something I've heard from like family folklore, I don't know if it's true, because of the crusades, the church has such a lot of wealth, like that was one of the main sources of their wealth. Is that true?
Because of the crusades.
Yeah.
So the loot and the booty in
the loot and yes, that caused the church to become so rich.
Yes, that is one of the reasons.
Right.
But the other one, church was the largest landholder, no?
True.
During the these centuries. So, and we will come to that when we speak of the indulgences as to how the church seems to have kind of grabbed the land from the poor peasant. Mm-hmm. But
yeah.
Also, yes, definitely one of the reasons how church became very rich.
Right.
Just always, you can take the examples of Indian wars also. You will always find that wars financed by the people who eventually end up losing the battle. So whoever wins,
right,
they obviously plunder, loot, or they say they will use the war or some such thing. In whichever world, they will always take the money from the
money.
People
who lose. Yeah. Okay.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Now, so far we saw the Crusades part of it. That is one of the factors, just like the Arab contribution. We just discussed the Crusades as one of the factors responsible for bringing about this ideological, intellectual process of the European Renaissance. Now we'll look at the some of the thinkers who offered their own interpretations of the world and how that seems to have brought about the process of the Renaissance. But I'll stop here for the English medium and go back to a few slides earlier and discuss the same in